Here we are, ready to go, search to grooves. I'm Jesse Quigley, sitting across from me, founder of Signl Radio, Jay Purcell. That makes this Roots to Grooves.
Hello, everybody. Welcome along.
For the ride of a lifetime, we're talking about Tom Misch.
Yeah.
An English producer, songwriter, extraordinaire, here on Roots to Grooves. This is a Jay pick. Welcome, everybody. Thanks for listening.
Thanks for listening.
Talk to me about Tom, Jay.
Well, so we've name dropped him a lot in various episodes. Mm-hmm. On our episode of Alpha Mist, we mentioned him. We mentioned him on our episode of with Jordan Rakai.
Yeah, he came up in my research.
And all three of these guys appear on a YouTube video somewhere out there where they're making a track together, I think over 2 days kind of thing. Which we alluded to, I think, on one of those episodes as well. But yeah, every time I mention Tom Misch, I ask you, have you heard of him? And you're like, I don't know.
In the past, I would have said no.
But now you do.
No, wait, who is he? Who are we talking?
But you hadn't come across him at all, like other than outside of Roots to Grooves?
Yeah, generally unfamiliar. Okay. Maybe I've heard some of his stuff on a playlist or something, you know, mm-hmm. couldn't say for sure, but I definitely don't recognize him. Didn't recognize his face when I saw him. Mm-hmm. Just one of those guys that must have slipped under the rug somehow. Because he's pretty chill. He's not big pop star in the tabloids doing crazy things.
Yeah.
He seems like a very chill, down-to-earth guy making really chill, down-to-earth music that vibes with a lot of people.
Yeah. And you kind of said it. He's a multi-instrumentalist, producer, mm-hmm. singer, songwriter.
Kind of guitar is his number one go-to instrument.
Yeah. And he's kind of, people have written about him, is at the intersection of like that crossing over of hip hop and jazz, mm-hmm. like that fusion sort of thing. Heavily inspired by Jay Dilla is like one of his biggest influences, I think.
For sure. So I'm wearing a Jay Dilla t-shirt.
Yeah.
In some videos.
But yeah, I guess downtempo, jazzy, hip hoppy. Throughout his discography, we'll talk about, he has other featured singers that he's worked with as mm-hmm. well. Maybe more jazz, I think, you know, maybe more
for sure,
like going through, especially with his guitar work and stuff like that, very jazzy.
Yeah, so, there's definitely an air of jazz throughout his discography, I think.
Yeah.
He studied jazz, right? He studied guitar, jazz guitar, I think. We're in the overview section, so we don't have to talk about anything else.
We'll get to it.
From
London, by the way. South London, Southeast London, South London.
Yeah, I thought I saw in an interview, I was going to try to write down the real city or the suburb or whatever, but it was like called Dutch or Deutsch or...
Oh, it was
like,
Dulwich.
Maybe that's what it was. Yeah. I just could not understand what it was on the video.
Yeah, it's one of those, another one of those places in the UK that is pronounced completely opposite of how it's spelled.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
I had a good time researching this guy. I just put it on Tom Misch music while I was researching. Nice. And it's just very, very good vibes.
Yeah, definitely.
Very chill. Like you said, hip hop, kind of R&B, jazz influence.
Yeah.
He has a couple albums out. His first full length LP came out in 2018.
Yeah.
Which we'll talk about. Mm-hmm. But how many full albums does he have?
He has one solid body of work that's just his, 2018 Geography.
You're right.
You could count Beat Tape 1, which is his first album, Beat Tape 2, second album, but I'll talk a little bit later about why I don't really consider those necessarily albums.
Mm-hmm.
But
interesting,
even though they are technically lengthwise and all that, but
right.
And then 2020, he came out with What Kind of Music with Yusuf Days, who's a drummer, who's probably another artist we should do a separate show on as well.
I found a couple other artists in the midst of this research to check out.
Yeah, yeah.
Which was exciting.
And Quarantine Sessions, which is just kind of a mini album of live things that he did mostly on YouTube during quarantine. Because...
Mm-hmm.
His last two releases seem to be very heavily marked by the COVID lockdown.
Right. Yeah. 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 So, which is fair.
Yeah.
Another cool project he had was where he worked on like five tracks in 5 days and released it just like the next week.
Mm.
So, just to point out how these different types of projects he's doing, he's not just by himself coming out with album after album.
Yeah.
You know, he's working, he's collaborating and doing different styles of releases and stuff like this. So
yeah.
Very interesting. So I say that's a nice little overview of Tom Misch for those who have not been aware, like myself. Mm. Should we play another track, give everybody a little taster?
Yeah, let's go a little bit more of a taster of Beat Tape 1.
Mm, I'm hungry.
The album, which I say is not an album, but you know, we'll see.
Not an album.
It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. Girl, you got me flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. You got me flying, flying, flying. Girl, you got me flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. Girl, you got me flying, 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 flying. You got me flying, flying, flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. Girl, you got me flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. It's 'cause we're flying, 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 flying. You got me flying.
Flying, you said it in the track. That was the name of the song.
I was flying.
Beat from Beat Tape 1 from Tom Misch here on Roots to Grooves, here on Signl.
A production of Signl Radio.
Yeah. And yeah, so he grew up in London his whole life. He still lives there. His mom's a graphic designer.
He used to live there, but he also used to.
Hmm? He doesn't live there anymore?
No. Well, he does, yeah. But he also used to live there.
Oh, okay. You're trying to be clever over here. Right? Okay.
Not so much.
So his dad is a psychiatrist, I think. And like I said, his mom a graphic designer. And she's actually really good because she did the artwork for some of his releases.
I had no idea.
Yeah. Specifically, I heard about the album Geography. His mom did the artwork, cover artwork for that.
Well, that's pretty cool. That's pretty huge because that's his first major release all on his own.
Yeah. And he said, you know, because his mom was kind of artistic as well, that creativity was always encouraged.
And that's artistic for us Americans, not autistic.
Did I say artistic?
That's what I hear when you say art.
Art.
It sounds the artistic. Same.
Yeah, it does, yeah.
Okay. Not calling anybody out. I'm just saying that's the way the world is.
His sister plays music as well. I think she acts. She's appeared doing vocals on some of Tom Misch's tracks as well. Her name's Laura Misch, I think you can find some of her stuff out there. She has a band camp I saw.
Nice.
And some stuff. His first instrument was actually the violin.
Yeah, so I saw he was, kind of coerced into playing it. Or you could use the word forced a little bit.
Probably the traditional learn piano or violin thing as a kid, right? Take lessons.
Like the classical instrument, you can't go wrong.
Yeah.
There's always going to be work for you if you know how to do this.
Yeah. And, well, I guess, yeah.
I mean, that's the idea, I guess.
Yeah. He learned, though, by the Suzuki method. Have you heard of this?
No, not. Yeah. I came across it on the research, though.
Yeah.
I did look into it a little bit.
Yeah.
It's apparently a specialized form of learning that's like based on ear training.
Okay.
And it's kind of a way to learn music through ear training. Mm. And I guess he was doing this while he was playing violin.
I saw on Wikipedia it said that it's the belief that musical ability is not an inborn talent but something that can be developed.
Okay.
Interesting. But I didn't know about the ear training part of it.
Yeah, I think we just put two and two together
with
the both of us here.
Yeah.
Which is why we're Rooster Grooves, you know? I think that's very true, though. I think it's just the kind of perspective of like how to go about looking at something, how to learn this.
Right.
And ear training is, that's how I learned to play, but not a lot of other people might start with, you know, a music sheet, but learning the notes and whatnot.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the opposite direction to come from.
Yeah, and me too. Drums was just listening to records and trying to play along to the records. Taking piano lessons around the same time, but the drum learning to drumming was purely just listening
just
to playing along to records, yeah. Seeing what they were doing and trying to imitate it on my little Mickey Mouse drum kit, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm kind of assuming like some studious teachers kind of used that same way and developed it into this Suzuki method to teach other young musicians is my understanding.
That's cool.
They're very cool.
Somewhere along the line, he did pick up guitar though. And he was listening to the usual stuff when you pick up a guitar as a teenager. Red Hot Chili Peppers and Nirvana was his staple. He said he learned all of the classic songs that you would learn from those bands and to try and play the guitar. Smells Like Teen Spirit, I'm pretty sure, was one of those.
Classic.
Maybe Under the Bridge, Red Hot Chili. I don't know. That's one of the ones I tried to learn as a young. I found a tab for it. I only learned the intro and then I couldn't take it past that.
That's mostly all you need.
I mean, that's the most complicated part.
Just play that at a party and you're a hit.
Exactly. He also got into sort of heavy metal stuff as well around that time.
Okay.
But it wasn't until his sister's boyfriend at the time introduced, this guy was a producer, musician as well, showed Tom, expanded his repertoire of music by introducing him to stuff like Jay Dilla and like hip hop stuff. And as soon as he first heard Jay Dilla, I think that's what really I want to make music like that. So it was interesting.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that put everything together from the perspective of how to come up with a track and then the technical stuff of I can sample things.
Yeah.
And put all these ideas together and do something that crazy. I could do that too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amazing.
And it wasn't until, so he was early teenage years, I think 15, maybe around that time. He was at least 16 when he started uploading to SoundCloud. So it wasn't long before that he learned some production techniques and trying to chop like Jay Dilla. As he was a bit older, he was going sixth form is when you're 16, 17. It's like when you finish high school and you do two more years of higher education learning before you go to college or university. It was that time he said he would have a long commute to and from school, and he would be listening to a lot of jazz records at that time and sort of thinking about how he could sample it, how he could chop it. And he was thinking about all these chords he was hearing and piano parts and stuff like that. And studying just straight jazz and how he could sample it. But I think at the back of his mind thinking, how can I do this in a Jay Dilla sort of
way? Kind of update it in my way. I guess since we're on this kind of early section, we're talking about Jay Dilla. I got a list of a few more influences I saw listed in an interview or something. Radiohead, Robert Glasper. Are you very familiar with him?
Not hugely, but I have. Most recently, I just played a couple of tracks on the drop in the last year or two from Robert Glasper, I think. Yeah.
Good stuff. Isley Brothers, D'Angelo, Catronata.
Yeah.
I think Catronata is actually a pretty substantial influence on him as well.
Yeah,
I just saw a photo with him as well.
Cool.
Together. Marvin Gaye, Aretha Franklin. Those last two are... I wasn't sure where to put those in the timeline.
Yeah.
I'm not sure when he was listening to those, if that was from when he was a kid or once he was getting into music production.
Right.
But a couple, you know, kind of those kind of jazzy and Motown older, old school kind of influence.
Yeah.
And then he's putting that together with modern stuff like, you know, Radiohead and J Dilla.
Right. Yeah.
So just to paint a little picture of influence.
Yeah. That's cool. And, so I think he was also studying music technology at sixth form,
is this high school?
This is like, what age do you graduate high school here in America?
Like 18.
Okay, so in England it's 16.
You graduate high school at 16?
Yeah, and then you can stay until you're 18.
And those are the former years?
Yeah, yeah. Nice. So I don't know how it works over here in America, but... In the UK, technically at 16, you finished high school, you could just leave, go work to a job or something like that. Or
join the army.
Join the army, yeah. But don't vote, yeah.
But you can't go buy a cigarette yet.
Exactly. And so like at some point along the line, he got a Mac, got Logic on it. And he said he just took to it real quickly, real easily. And that's... was his tool of choice, and I think he still uses that now, Logic, to
stay with what he knows.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Logic is very comprehensive.
Yeah.
And so very intuitive as well.
Yeah.
I also use Logic. I back it up. It's got my stamp of approval.
Yes.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
So he's releasing stuff as a 16 to 18-year-old teenager on SoundCloud a lot.
Yeah.
A lot of tracks.
Yeah. Yeah, he said he would just keep putting stuff out. He said he'd basically finish a beat in like 2 hours and then just immediately upload it to SoundCloud. And
yeah, he was just kind of like a daily beat, basically, like one per day and upload it quickly.
Yeah,
just quickly learning skills.
Yeah, yeah.
So awesome. And this was before he went to college to study music, right?
Yeah.
Or specifically jazz guitar.
Yeah, so I think he'd started to sort of integrate his guitar playing into the beats he was making.
Mm-hmm.
But he sort of kind of blew up a little bit through SoundCloud at that time. Started to get a lot of followers, get a lot of listeners.
Mm-hmm.
He said it was funny timing because it was after he'd just finished school and he'd signed up for some music theory class to like study like jazz guitar specifically, I think. And so he'd already blown up on SoundCloud and he was already getting interviewed and he was like, oh, but I still have this course coming up and I'm still going to do it kind of thing. And I've heard him talk about it subsequently, how that really, really advanced his guitar playing, taught him a lot of like crazy jazz scales and chord progressions and stuff like that, that he's been able to sort of riff on and jam with and integrate in his tracks.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah, so we're talking about, we're basically in 2012 is this time period.
Yeah.
Is that right?
I think so, yeah.
Ish,
yeah.
So other up-and-coming rappers were sampling his stuff as well.
Yeah, did you hear about this?
A little bit.
Okay.
You probably know more than me. What do you got?
I don't know about that, yeah.
I know he was collaborating with other singer-songwriters like Carmody, like we played.
Mm-hmm.
Is that how you say it? Carmody? Carmody?
I never heard anyone pronounce it, but I read it and say it in my mind is Carmody.
Carmody.
Because it sounds cool, but I don't know if that's how you say
it. Carmody.
Carmody.
Yeah, some Carmody.
Yeah. I think her first name is Jess. I think that's literally our last name.
Okay.
Carmody. Yeah.
Jess, it's a great name.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's basically all I got in my notes was other rappers were sampling him, which is a good sign
that
people are listening and they're...
Yeah.
You know, kind of that old adage, the best form of praise is like thievery or whatever.
Right. Yeah.
Ish.
That's
close enough.
Close enough. That'll do it.
So what then? So now he's in college.
And he's still putting stuff out on SoundCloud. At the same time, he's still getting a lot of interest in that. Joe Kay, who I've mentioned before, really influential radio show he does called Soulection. I think it's now on Apple Music. Back in the day, it was on some local station in California somewhere, mm-hmm. or something like that. His show's really influential, and he was like back in the day big on SoundCloud and digging for music on there. He reposted a lot of Tom Misch's stuff and approached him. Eventually he sent him an email and said, can I put out some stuff on the Soulection label? And so he put together a white label vinyl that had about 3 tracks on it. I heard Tom Misch say he said it was great, and he said he sent Joe Kay a bunch of tracks, and 2 of them he didn't like, and he was like, oh damn, it's like, because he really like Tom really liked those tracks, and
yeah.
Joe Kay was like, no, I'm not putting those out, so that's fine.
Oh, it's hurt.
But yeah, that and some airplay on his thing really like blew up his fan base and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I think,
yeah, he was getting some attention.
Yeah, and so you know, he was also, I think, at some point studies something around music business stuff. Tom did.
Yeah. Yeah, I think some music technology.
Right. But that says something about business as well, because he has established his own record label, Beyond the Groove, and he only releases music on his own label, which is crazy. So I thought he would be on some big thing, because he's kind of pretty well known. I think he might have a publishing deal with someone bigger or something like that.
But, mm-hmm. but he wants to retain the rights to the creative aspects or whatever.
I think so, yeah. It's like he said he got a manager pretty early on, he said. And, you know, Tom was still in the mentality of doing quick beats, putting them out. And he was spending a little bit more time on certain tracks, like 2 months kind of thing. And mm-hmm. his manager was like, no, this is good. You need to, don't put this out for free. Like, someone might want to buy this kind of thing.
Yeah.
Encouraged him to have a little bit more of a strategy behind releasing his material versus just pumping stuff out.
Put some value behind it.
But I think I've also heard Tom say that, but you know, kind of you have to do that to start out with everything, put it out for free, especially now, right? It's how you get noticed. You know, you're not going to get noticed any other way. Mm-hmm. You could play shows, but yeah. who plays shows these days without a release out somewhere on Spotify? It's kind of rare, you know.
Doesn't happen.
No, because you've got to capitalize on these things, right? You've got to play the show to support the release and vice versa.
And sell the merch at the show.
Sell the merch and all that, you know. The economy, the dynamics of modern day music
career, industry.
Music industry, yeah.
The business.
And yeah, I said earlier, because his first two albums, Beat Tape 1, Beat Tape 2, I said they're not really albums because most of these tracks came from his just constant beat making sessions.
Okay, so those releases, previous releases added up. Are you saying he re-recorded these tracks or
no.
just took them and slapped them on an album and called it good?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so it's almost like a mixtape type thing.
Yeah. So he didn't sit down and like, I'm going to write an album now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go to a shack in Hawaii. And
With
Rick Rubin. yeah, by the way, side note, new Red Hot Chili Peppers album out.
Yeah.
Tom Misch is into them, I think. He was. He might still be.
Yeah.
I was waiting for it for ages, and then I suddenly saw it's already been out. There's already like 5 music videos out.
Yeah, dude. They rolled it out pretty quick.
And then I was listening to a little bit of Rick Rubin's podcast. He mm-hmm. interviewed John Frusciante and the singer. What's his name?
Anthony Kiedis.
Yeah, together. And then I think he had a separate one with Flea. I haven't listened to them a while. I listened to half of part 2 of the,
you started with halfway through part 2.
I just saw the parts and I was like, I never heard, like,
fast forward.
I just saw Rick Rubin. It's like, because he's known them for ever,
right?
And it's like listening to his podcast, like being privy to that world, that mm-hmm. relationship that they have, producer and band kind of thing,
just like, life experience in general.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Amazing. I haven't given it a chance to listen to it, so don't ruin it for me.
But the music's good. The album is classic Red Hot Chili. Like, they still have it.
I've been listening to it. I'm impressed. They bring it. It sounds like old Chili's.
Yeah.
They have good. It sounds pretty fresh. It's good to have John back.
Yeah.
It's really fun.
A lot of crazy drumming on it as well.
Yeah, so good. It's just, I mean, what's his name? Chad Smith?
Chad Smith, yeah.
Just so good. It's just like a masterclass in drumming the whole time.
Yeah. I saw someone's comment on YouTube. This is Chad's album. They were like, forget Frusciante being back. This is Chad Smith's album because of all the drum, crazy drumming he's doing on it. But
I think they killed it.
They did. Yeah. Side note. But yeah. Where were we?
we're coming up. We're talking about Beat Tape 1.
Beat Tape 1.
So this is it's a mixtape from 2014.
Yeah.
A collection of instrumental tracks that this includes Dilla Love. So homage to one of his homies, Jay Dilla.
Yeah.
You share a name with Jay Dilla, Jay.
Oh,
I guess.
Yeah, I guess.
It's just a Jay and Jay Dilla, right? Just the letter?
Not like for Jay. Him, yeah. I don't know what his...
Should you go by just the J?
No, J-A-Y.
Jay Purcell.
Yeah, no.
Just an idea.
I did a DJ set recently and I introduced myself or someone else introduced me. It's like, this is Jay. He's going to DJ tonight. And they were like, oh, DJ Jay?
DJ Jay.
And I was like, I was like, oh, maybe not. No, I just felt a bit weird. I was like, oh, okay. Because I'm not actually a DJ, by the way, people. A drummer first.
Musician first.
Imposter DJ second.
Well, but general music curator and lover.
Yeah.
So.
But, so he, and also he does sing, Tom Misch, and in his early stuff, he didn't really incorporate it.
Mm-hmm.
I think partly, it seems from what I can gather from reading about things about him, it was like two reasons. Like one, he wanted to focus more on the Jay Dilla-esque sort of instrumental stuff. And second, there was still obviously that little bit of confidence behind his voice kind of thing that he had to build up a little bit, I think, before sort of really putting it out there. But there is Beat Tape 1, which is like all instrumental. Beat Tape 2 starts to introduce some of his own vocals, as well as other guest vocalists. Some really great tracks on there, actually. But he sort of intentionally curated both of these beat tapes out of material that he'd been working on for like a few years kind of thing.
Right. Quick, not to go back and forth, but I should have finished my sentence before, but he had that on the Beat Tape 1 Dilla Love track, which is a cool track. And I guess he got approval from Jay Dilla's mother.
I saw that.
Maureen Yancey.
Yeah, yeah.
Because Jay Dilla has passed.
Yeah.
If we're not aware, so you know, rest in peace. But that's a cool little fun fact tidbit that his mom was like, "Props, bro." So cool. Beat Tape 2 is next, or what? A Memory comes out. Do we put Memory on our list? Want to spin Memory?
Yeah, I'll spin it, and then.
So this one's right in between Beat Tape 1 and Beat Tape 2, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, and I think. Somewhere along the line, well, I'll tell the full story afterwards, but I think this song was his first official release.
I think you're right. Yeah, on his Beyond the Groove label.
Yeah. Thank you.
falls. Cause I feel it, and you're climbing up with me. Your absence is to rip me apart. When I close my eyes, you're still climbing up with me. Tonight I'm sleeping under the stars. Cause I feel it, and you're climbing up with me. Your absence used to rip me apart. When I close my eyes, you're climbing up with me. In my memory, 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 memory,
track called Memory from Tom Misch. That was his first official single on his own record label, Beyond the Groove.
What a strong track.
Yeah.
Just showcasing all his skills, because there's sampling in there.
Yeah.
The guitar's awesome.
Yeah.
Just like his vocals.
Yeah.
Everything's wrapped up in this track and it's very good.
Violin. That's him playing violin as well.
No way.
Layered up. Yeah.
Check mm-hmm. that out.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah, he said, because usually like, we've been saying he likes to make a track in 2 hours, which is great. Mm-hmm. I aspire to that level of being able to be done.
Yeah, letting it go, calling it done and moving on.
Because I have a problem finishing things if I don't finish it in one session. I'm like, trying to get back into it.
I'm waiting for this next J. Purcell track to drop. It's been months, dude. I'm waiting.
You
showed me it. I'm ready.
I'll play you something I'm quite happy about, but I haven't finished it yet.
Okay, fine.
After off air.
Sorry, not for you guys. Special privileges.
But about that track, he said it started with the piano, just the piano chord progression.
Mm-hmm.
Then he added the drums, and that was it. And then he left it for like 2 months. Then he came back to it, and then he started playing around with it, adding the violins, started to try and figure out the structure, adding the singing. He described this as kind of like a maze of like, he had all these ideas and was trying to figure out how to shape the track.
Mm-hmm.
And so he said that it's like a maze, got to figure out the right path to get through it and out of it.
Right.
Which is interesting, yeah, because if like, especially if an instrumental track, or any track maybe, it's like you build up all this bed of sonic stuff, ideas, right? And then you have to kind of like, what fits where? Maybe some stuff needs to go away.
Mm-hmm.
Like, how does it all fit? How does it progress and stuff like that? It is a crazy art. Like,
it's like the image of what you're describing, like, conjures in my mind, like somebody, like a detective, and they got their big board and all, like the threads right. are connecting different photographs. And like,
yeah,
because it's like I have the trumpets, I have the guitar, the bass, the drums. If I take the drums out here, then this part sounds weird without drums.
Yeah.
You know, but if I add this part, it doesn't work with the drums.
Yeah.
So it's like all these things integrating and working with each other or working against each other. And how do you make that the best version possible?
Yeah, yeah. And that's like, you know, I think there's two arts to like this, or any music making, I guess, these days. It's like, it's the creative part, just coming up with all of the stuff. And then it's like figuring out the maze, the game, the puzzle, like how it all fits together or doesn't fit together. And, you know. And I think it's possible, you just have to keep working through it, and then you eventually, you know, get to it, sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
He said, like, you know, with this track, he was so happy with it, he wanted to put it out as a free download. He sent it to his manager, and his manager was like, no, we've got to release this properly. Like, this is too good.
Still good.
It's too good. And did I say it reminds me of Bonobo a little bit? I don't know if I said
that.
Oh,
you did not say that today, but
yeah, I think it a little bit that
100%.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That kind of chill wave, downtempo, instrumental vibe.
EDM-y or something.
Mm-hmm.
Just the way the sound, the production of all the sounds is
right.
A little bit.
Like, yeah, I mean, great track. That one's really fun for anybody.
Yeah.
For everybody. So let's move on. Beat tape 2.
Yeah.
2015.
Yeah. And before this, actually, like he, well, there is a track on beat tape 2 with the singer Carl Moody.
Mm-hmm.
But I think before this, he did like an actual EP with her as a duo. 5 songs. He produced all the music. She wrote all the lyrics, did all the vocals.
Okay, is this released under Tom Misch, or is it released only under Carmody?
I think it was released as both.
Okay.
Misch and Carmody, it says on the album cover or EP artwork.
Okay. My apologies then.
And yeah, I think when they were talking about this, so apparently she like lives in the same area as him, or like down the street. And I've heard 2 stories of how they met, which is very interesting from each of them.
2 different stories.
Yeah. So maybe there's some like things that need to be connected here. But Tom Misch said that Komodi lived with her family just down the street. He knew her sister, and his parents were like friends with their parents.
Mm.
But then I heard from Carmody that she was like working with another producer and said, oh, you should get together with Tom to like produce some music, kind of thing. So maybe she didn't even realize who he was, and the whole time like their parents were friends or whatever.
Yeah, interesting.
I don't know. Interesting.
So their parents.
And then so he basically he did a few shows with her just in the local area doing guitar. She was singing. But then she was really trying to put together some music and get a release together, and needed a producer.
Mm-hmm.
So he worked with her on this EP, Out to Sea, it's called, came out in 2014. And then she appears on his beat tape 2 as well, which is a really great track. First time I heard her, actually, I think, was today, listening to the track she's on beat tape 2.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
very good. There's a couple other features, such as Loyal Karner,
yeah,
and Zach Abel.
Right.
I don't recognize those names, but they're on there.
Yeah.
And it's good stuff.
Yeah.
I do know Beat Tape 2. I heard Tom Misch say it's based around the reflections of his life and his experiences, his feelings.
Mm-hmm.
And his general thoughts at the time of recording it.
Yeah.
Just, you know, fun fact about Beep Tape 2.
Cool. Yeah.
That's all I got in that.
Yeah. Do we want to play one of these Comody tracks? Comody?
We've said the name so many times. Yeah. I think we have to.
Which one? Do you want to play the one off her EP or the one off the Beep Tape 2? It's the toss up. You selected one. I selected the other.
Oh, really? Yeah. I don't remember which one I selected, but let's do Beat Tape 2.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
I know, I'm getting heavy Bonobo vibes from that track again as
yeah.
well.
I mean, very good.
Yeah.
Great vocals by Carmody as well.
Yeah. Tom Misch, Wonder With Me, Beat Tape 2. That was from.
Another really strong track.
Yeah.
I don't know, even just in this episode, I feel like I can feel the progression that Tom is taking.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these tracks are just hitting really hard and really,
yeah,
you know, they just, it feels really right to listen to.
Yeah.
I think it's a good sign when I'm listening to music, at least. I'll speak for myself.
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah, cool. Reverie,
mm-hmm.
2016, drops an EP.
Ah, okay.
I mean, I don't really have anything on this, but he dropped it.
Yeah.
We don't have to go into it, but it's blending a lot of the aspects of his music into, you know, laid back R&B, R&B tinged pop, you could say.
Okay.
You know, a little poppy, but he's on lead vocals on a few of these as well.
Okay.
Sounding very good.
Yeah. That's probably like when he was doing it more, his vocals, Reverie.
Yeah, I think he was just getting this. No, this EP was probably, I'm just speculating, but you know, kind of where he started to really reach for it and be like, I'm gonna do vocals,
right?
Not a full-length album yet, but let's get an EP out of some material, as a learning and growing experience for himself, and great music for everybody else. So that's all I got on that. Can we move on to the next year?
Yeah, absolutely.
2017, he released South of the River, I think is the single.
Yeah.
And then also in 2017, he had, this is the 5-day mission. I think that's how you pronounce it. Is that right?
Yeah, I'm going to pronounce it Michon because it looks French to me.
Okay. I saw
5-day Michon.
I was going off Mission.
Michon.
Because his name is M-I-S-H or C-H.
Yeah.
And then it sounds like Mission.
I think it's meant to be Michon.
Yeah. So it's definitely like a double entendre.
Yeah. I'm just trying to add the French to it.
Michon.
Michon.
I'm on a 5-day Michon.
Yeah.
For 5 tracks.
Exactly.
Horrible French accent. I'm sorry if that's disrespectful, everybody.
Peter Sellers, eat your heart out.
Yeah.
Pink Panther. Do you know, get my reference there?
No, no, I was struggling. I was like, okay, I know Pink Panther.
Do you know who Peter Sellers is?
He's the guy in that?
Yeah. You haven't heard of him outside of that? Oh, man. I've got to show you some movies.
Okay. Yeah, I'm down.
Okay. The Kubrick movie. About, it's all black and white.
The Shining? No.
No. What's it called? Jesus Christ. Carry on. You're going to say something. I'll find this.
Okay. Yeah. So his 5-day mission was an EP where he set about, you know, to, what's the word? He consciously wanted to create 5 songs recorded in 5 days and then release them, you know, fairly shortly after.
Okay.
So it's featuring contributions from Carmody again, an artist named Novelist, Will Hurd, Katie Ackenby. Some of these people I haven't heard of, so that's why it sounds like I don't know who I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And then Toby Tripp.
Okay.
He's got a good name.
Yeah.
Haven't heard of him though.
Okay.
But just more good stuff.
Yeah.
Mostly what I think is interesting is that he wanted to
do
this kind of project and kind of box himself in.
Yeah, yeah.
We've talked about that before, how sometimes giving yourself limits can allow you to be more free and to experience different things.
Yeah.
You know, so just that he's trying to do something in a different way, I back that up.
Yeah, I like it. I'm a fan of that because, like, I've been involved in too many projects where they just drag on for years. I think I mentioned this before where I'd literally recorded a session of drums in the UK, 2006. 5 years later, I get a CD in the mail. Like they've finished the recordings, like they added a bunch of other stuff to it. And I was like, that's too long, man. The world has moved on.
You did. Could you listen to it? Like, I don't remember that drum beat anymore.
Yeah, no, yeah, I don't remember. I was like, did I play on that? Is that actually me? I don't know anymore. It could have been.
Were you, what did you feel when you heard it? Like, was, oh, this sounds good. This is
cool. Thought it sounded good when we were working on it 5 years beforehand, and I think it had been too overworked.
Yeah.
I think, like, no, too much overthinking happened.
Well, I mean, there you go. Yeah. That's a good example, though.
Yeah. I mean, it was good, but I was like, but it wasn't drastically better than the I'd heard before.
Not worth a 5-year wait.
No.
It didn't seem, interesting.
And so, I'm a big fan of boxes, working on stuff, deadlines, and putting stuff out. Like, you have,
because, giving yourself personal limits.
Yeah. And especially, like, if you're a musician trying to make a career out of it, you have to release stuff. Like, mm-hmm. you just have to, even if you're not ready to, like, just finish it. I think there's a difference between, like, feeling that your talents aren't ready yet versus knowing when something's finished, right?
Yeah, the mutually exclusive.
Yeah, because I feel like, you know, I can always get better at drumming, but I've got this project that's got my drums in it. I know when it's good enough to say that it's finished, sort of thing.
Under that logic, like, I'm still practicing drumming. I'm still getting better. So I'm going to wait 40 years and then I'll be really good and I'll release the best album ever.
Yeah.
You know,
I mean, you just have to, and this, there's other things that come into this as well, like with content, like marketing yourself as a musician and stuff like that. But the big thing people were talking about now is documenting your process.
Right.
And I feel like, you know, even if you don't vlog or blog or whatever, like, if you just putting out the music you're making, that's showing, that's documenting the process as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because other artists do it. You know, if you look at, like, Blur's first album to where, like, Damon Albarn is now as a songwriter, it's kind of very different. You know,
that's true.
You can hear the progression. And it's cool to hear the progression, I think, you know. Mm-hmm.
Anyway, I mean, yeah, but what would have happened if they never released that first one? He might not be doing Gorillaz.
No.
Or the same kind of thing.
Exactly, yeah.
If he hadn't gone through that experience before.
Yeah, yeah. So, anyway, digression, but I love that idea. The five-day mission.
Yeah, I
yeah.
Stamp of approval.
Yeah.
It's got mine. That is cool.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people can utilize that in your own production at home.
Mm-hmm.
So, now let's talk about the big daddy, geography.
Geography.
So this is his first full-length LP featuring Tom Misch on, you know, sampling on real instruments, on vocals, and even his mom as an artist doing the cover art.
Yeah, she did the cover artwork.
Very cool.
Yeah. I think his sister's on a track somewhere.
Cool.
Doing background vocals or something.
Didn't know that.
Yeah.
The singles were Movie and Lost in Paris.
Right. Yeah.
Talk to me about geography.
Solid. It's
2018.
Yeah. And it's the first time he sat down to be like, I'm gonna make an album.
With the goal of making an album.
Yeah. And you could hear it glues together really well. I think this is the first time in his music it sounds like there's a lot of live drums in it. I'm not sure who did it. Sorry, Mr. Drummer, find your name or something. But live feel to a lot of these tracks, I think, versus strictly like in the box or whatever. Like,
I was gonna say, I think even on this album, it was where you could hear, like, at the beginning, I think it is, or at the beginning of a track, you can hear like the toms being tuned a little bit, and it really gives this live feel. Like, you feel like, oh, I'm listening to some people making music, not something that feels terribly cold and, you know, sampled, and yada yada.
And it even, the album even starts out with a monologue. I think I heard, I didn't hear it all the way through. I heard a journalist write about it. I think the monologue is about kind of his approach to music. I'm not sure if it's him saying it or a sample he got to do it. But it even starts out kind of field recording-esque, sort of atmospheric before it gets into the music.
Like, so, yeah, kind of keeping in a theme, which is cool.
Yeah,
I was almost going to say, how long is that first monologue?
It's 2:29. We could spin it and see what's happening.
I was going to say,
Yeah.
Starting to try to be a musician or an artist, something like that, because you want to make money, because you want to do a job. That's the wrong way. You have to do this because you love it. And it doesn't matter if you broke, you still going to do it. I mean, I go out to jam sessions, and I play regardless of whether I'm getting a check or not. It's about whether I, you have to love this thing, man. You have to love it and breathe it. It's your morning coffee. It's your food. That's why you become an artist. Art is a mirror of society. Thank you.
Yeah. So I don't know where he got that sample from.
Yeah, I don't think it was him.
Wasn't him, but yeah.
Anyway, cool track in general to start start off, you know, as an intro.
And a good statement about music. Yeah. I mean, yeah, that's true. That's why
yeah, everything that guy said, whoever that random dude is.
Yeah.
I want to find out.
We'll find out. He's, yeah, because, I mean, that's why I'm here. You got to just do it. You live and breathe it, if it, you know.
Yeah.
You do music because you have to, not because, you know, you're going to make money out of it or something like that.
Yeah. No, I do like how he said that it's art is a reflection of society.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's pretty weird when you think about it all. Does art imitate life or does life imitate art?
So it was Roy Hargrove that said that in an iRock Jazz interview.
Who is Roy Hargrove?
Roy Hargrove. Real name, Roy Anthony Hargrove. I'm going to look up. I'm going to say he's a jazz musician. Because that seems right.
Place your bets. Place your bets.
He was passed away. American jazz musician and composer. Trumpet and flugelhorn. He won 2 Grammy Awards. So...
Okay, he made some waves.
Yeah, yeah. So that's who said that.
Very cool.
Well, music's like my morning cup of coffee.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like that.
Wakes you up and it puts you to sleep.
Yeah.
Hopefully we're waking you up, though, here on Rooster Grooves.
Hopefully.
We're talking about Tom Misch. I'm here with Jay Purcell. I'm Jesse Quigley.
This is Rooster Grooves.
Do we want to play? Yeah. We need some sound effect, guys, like that movie announcer.
Oh, yeah. I have these, but I think it's going to record, so never mind.
Oh, no. Yeah, I'll put them in post.
Yeah.
Anyway, do we want to play one more track off this or are we good?
Yeah, let's play one more. Yeah.
Okay. I did have one that I loaded up.
Yeah.
If you're willing to play that one.
Yeah.
Because I don't know. I think this one gave me some Thundercat vibes when I was listening to Tom.
Okay.
And that I was like, I checked my phone. I was like, is this still Tom Misch? Right. But it was very good. Just really jammy track.
Okay.
Very fun. Very good.
What is it called?
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought we had it. I thought it's Disco Yes.
All right.
We'll be right back.
Disco Yes.
Yeah.
From Geography, featuring Poppy Ajuda on vocals. I've played her a few of her new releases on the drop as well.
Nice.
Recognize that name. She's cool.
Yeah, South London jazz and soul singer.
Yeah.
Melodic craftsman.
Melodic craftsman, like that. And yeah, I was looking up the liner notes for this album because you said it sounded like Thundercat.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, who's the bass player then? I think he played the bass himself.
Oh, for real?
Yeah. Fucking great.
Wow. I mean, but what a fun track, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's just like definitely upbeat and just jamming and just like good energy.
Yeah, yeah.
Just feels good. Makes you feel good.
Yeah.
And I like that about it.
Roy Hargrove. Oh, no. I mentioned him. Sorry. Jamie Horton is the drummer. But he didn't play on all the tracks. He's only featured on track one and track five. Which leads me to believe that maybe Tom Misch sampled this guy's drum kit and programmed the rest of the drums on the other.
Ouch.
Because that sounds live on like a lot of these tracks, and especially that one as well. It sounds like a live drum kit, but I guess he programmed it or something to be that way.
Which, I mean, we live in an age where you can do both, have live instruments, like have somebody play hours worth of drums, and then you can take those, chop those transients out and put them in a
reconfigure it, put them in a sampler. Or
yeah, I don't know the flyer. Words that what you guys do, hit the buttons with the things,
a MIDI controller.
Yeah, make the buttons work. And I got my snare.
Right,
but it's crazy how you can do that. Like I'm kind of joking around, but everyone knows you can just take other people's sounds and sample them and put them as a button on MIDI and then control it and make different beats.
But the hardest thing is getting that what seems like a performance or like
just making it feel real again.
Yeah, like the swing or whatever, and not just the drums, but in any sample instrument. It's like
your
sounds are easy. Putting them on a MIDI thing is easy, but making it sound
that's like only half the job. Like, create it and make it sound like a real drummer, which is a whole art in itself, I suppose.
Yeah,
more of a technical thing.
And I guess like didn't maybe Daft Punk do that on their last album as well? This is all disco heavy, sounds like live drums, but I'm pretty sure they programmed it all or something like that. Maybe
I wouldn't doubt it. I'm not sure.
Yeah,
I do know they were doing as much live stuff as possible.
Yeah,
so I could definitely see it going both ways.
Okay,
because obviously they're known for sampling and production.
Yeah, yeah.
I just simply do not know.
Right.
I love me some Daft Punk and some Random Access Memories though.
Well, this song you could mix this in with Random Access Memories.
Yeah,
like, yeah. Disco.
That is kind of a throwback.
Yeah. Yeah.
Fun.
I want to hear that track again now. I just want to hear that.
Yeah. we'll play out with it.
Okay.
So moving along, that's Geography.
Yeah. One thing I guess I want to say about this before we move on is, that he felt like he didn't have enough time for this. So he had a deadline to do this album.
It was like a year and a half.
Yeah. He said 2 months before the deadline, he only had 10% done. He said, so he said it wasn't really an enjoyable time. He wanted to take more time and enjoy the process, make the best stuff when I have time and enjoy the process. So I was forcing creativity. My friends were doing fun stuff and going somewhere for a holiday, and I was just in a studio grinding. Though I've learned a lot of stuff from the process, it's really important to enjoy the process regardless of anything else. So good learning curve for him. Was that the deadline didn't really work for him. Like it kind of felt, gave him a bit of pressure maybe and some anxiety.
Well, but I'm wondering, because I thought I heard him saying, talking about Geography, and he was like, oh, I have like a year and a half to work on this. And so I'm feeling really chill about it.
Yeah.
And I'm working on other stuff.
Right.
And if that's the same story, then I don't know what he's talking about.
Because maybe he started out that way and then he was like, oh shit, it's only like two months left.
Oh, I guess I can't go on vacation now. Aw. I don't know. I'm just kidding. I'm speculating.
But as we've had a similar thing with other artists we've talked about, where they've abandoned albums or that they just completed it and released it but weren't happy with it.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't sound like that Tom Misch is not happy with this album. I think he is, and I think he should be proud of it, because regardless of that comment that I saw him say there that I just read out, like this is a really solid piece of work and good proper first album outside of the beat tapes, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
And still only his real proper album, like
as a artist
as a solo thing, so but yeah, so I mean, so to move on, like that was Geography, when did that come out?
2018.
Yeah, and then so and then COVID happened. in 2019, I don't know, I've lost track now.
That's what they're saying. What kind of music?
Yeah, so this is a whole album he did with Yusuf Days, who's a London drummer, crazy drummer.
Yeah, stylish fellow, seems like he has a lot of experience.
Yeah.
He's drummed a lot of drums.
Drums a lot of drums. If you check out Yusuf Days on Instagram, you can see him, all these random clips he puts out. And that's explosions in the background, people, from the stadium down here in Seattle.
Yeah.
Who's playing tonight? Is it Seahawks or something?
Soccer.
Soccer? It's not NFL season right now.
Seattle Sounders. No, yeah. No, football's done, but Mariners opening day is tomorrow.
There you go. Right.
So this will be in the past when you guys listen to this, but go see a Mariners game.
Yeah.
Go San Diego Padres.
Yeah, so Yusuf Days, great drummer. Check him out on Instagram. You can see how he plays. There's also a lot of video clips on YouTube.
Yeah, I was watching some of them play together. Just very good.
Yeah, and so this came about because apparently Yusuf lives in the same neighborhood as Tom, and he went to the album release party for Geography, and that's how they met.
Okay, nice.
And Yusuf went up to Tom and was like, yeah, man, we should get into the studio sometime and like mess around. He was like, yeah.
Oh, totally. We should jam.
Yeah, we should jam, dude. Yeah. Yeah, man. Never happens. No. We should get a drink sometime. Yeah.
Yeah.
Never happens. But they did happen. And they just said they just started around by experimenting. They were thinking another beat tape. They were just thinking like little
casual
side project sort of thing. But their experimentations went further. Tom said he wanted it just to be like instrumental initially, but like as they were creating cool things, he was like, it would be a shame to not like work on pursuing each of these songs a bit further kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so he added vocals. They had some other people come through, feature Freddie Gibbs, Rocco Palladino as well. This last person, KD Akinibi. Not sure.
Oh, yeah.
If I spelled that correctly. And they ended up doing a 12-song album, 45 minutes, written during, was it lockdown? I think it was. Like most of 2020, they spent working on this, and it came out towards the end of 2020, I think.
Yeah, because he also had the quarantine sessions.
Right, yeah.
Which that came out first or second? I don't know.
Second, yeah.
Came out after what kind of music?
That's kind of what he's been doing since that album. He was... a lot of YouTube, a lot of him sitting in his backyard on the guitar on YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
Quarantine sessions. Yeah.
And that's the image on that album cover, I believe, too, is kind of like a picture of him sitting in his yard, basically just
there you go.
Isolated.
Yeah.
Quarantining. Good job.
Yeah.
What is it? Flatten the line. We're going to flatten the curve.
Flatten the curve. Yeah. It's been a long time, man. It's crazy now because it doesn't feel that long to me that since COVID started, but now we've had so much art that's been written during this time and already released.
Mm-hmm.
Not just music, but films and like books, all kinds of things.
Right.
And I'm like, whoa.
Yeah.
It's kind of cool though, actually, because you get this, I think it's something Tom said as well, is like you either use that time to, as an artist, work on your craft and work on projects, or you just check out and, do some kind of self-care type stuff or spend time with your family kind of thing. And I think we've seen it all across the gamut, but I think there's been a lot of artists that have done a lot of great work in this time period and gotten really good.
Mm-hmm.
And we're getting a lot of good music and art and just all kinds of shit.
Content
out of it.
In general.
Yeah.
You know, it gave everybody opportunity to work on some cool stuff.
Yeah.
And I mean, and it's cool getting to reflect and look back on the pandemic.
Yeah.
Now that we're kind of out of the woods a little bit, so to speak.
Yeah.
Or so it seems, at least. Not so much in China right now. Back to China.
Yeah.
You like that? The Red Hot Chili Peppers line in that first song, Black Summer.
Oh yeah, yeah.
China's on the dark side of the moon.
Yeah. I to be honest with you, I can never understand Anthony Kiedis' lyrics, so yeah. I wasn't sure what he was talking about. Maybe I need to listen more carefully. But what was he talking about?
I don't know what the context of that line is, but I specifically remember China is on the dark side of the moon.
Right.
Just like one of the opening lines of the song.
Yeah. It was great, like the way he puts it in there and with the other lyrics, like mm-hmm. that verse or whatever. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. I like it. I'm going to play. I'm going to New Orleans this weekend, so I'm going to. I've kind of held off listening to the whole album, the new Red Hot Chili Peppers album.
Oh.
I kind of want it to be one of those times, you know, where like you listen to music and you like, and then every time you go back to that album, it reminds you of a time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So this is going to be my New Orleans album. I'm going there. I'm gonna listen to the album a couple of times.
That's good.
Like, whilst I'm down there. Also, let's see if I can make this happen. I might go see them play at Jazz Fest. Because they replaced Foo Fighters. Unfortunately, Foo Fighters had to cancel headlining Jazz Fest in New Orleans. But Red Hot Chili Peppers stepped into play. So,
rest in peace, Taylor Hawkins.
Yeah, yeah.
We haven't said that on this show yet.
Yeah. It's all sad.
Legend.
It's a sad thing.
Sorry to see that happen.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, anyway, cool opportunity for the Red Hot Chili Peppers to take over.
Yeah. That'd be an experience.
That would be very cool.
But anyway, yeah, it's kind of got me excited to like listen to albums again. It's like it's a thing, you know. Instead of just casually listening to music throughout my day, it's like let me purposefully sit down.
Well, and that's
and
like
listen
doing
to this album
with intention.
Yeah, yeah,
and yeah, it's kind of like what we were mentioning before, like giving yourself a limit or a rule in order to achieve something greater.
Yeah,
because we could have just had Chili Peppers playing in the background all day.
Yeah.
That's not going to give you the same
feeling
if you have that on your headphones and you're landing in New Orleans and you're walking around the town with it in your headphones and really like dial in that experience.
Like listening to the details of the music. Because they've got a really good production sound, what I've heard so far in that album.
Yeah, it's crisp. Yeah, drums sound great, like we mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
Sorry, this is not a Red Hot Chili Peppers episode.
Sorry.
But anyway, what kind of music?
Yeah.
With Yusuf Days, very good.
Yeah.
And I think we kind of touched on that. The one other thing I wanted to say was one of the spotlight tracks is called Kyiv.
Okay, yeah.
And that's a city in Ukraine who is currently being invaded by Russia.
Yeah.
So kind of a cool shout out. I don't remember the specifics of that song, but I'm sure they kind of just touch on the...
And I think they called it
that.
They're
experiencing.
And put it on here before the war happened.
Is that right?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Okay. So, I don't know the...
Yeah.
Context of that, but I just know that that is
a
city in Ukraine that it seems to be a poignant time that really was released.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's all I have. Yeah. Anyway, but and then Quarantine Sessions is the latest thing that he's released.
Yeah.
Back to Tom Misch. Sorry for the tangents, everybody. Send some hate mail if you feel like it.
But I'm going to say Tom Misch is a Red Hot Chili Peppers fan. If he listened to them back in the day like I did.
I mean, he was one of the influences.
Yeah.
And yeah, you were over there listening too.
Yeah, I was. He's younger than me, I guess. But like, yeah. I mean, that was my teenage years. Grew up listening to Blood Sugar Sex Magik.
Mm-hmm.
All the ones.
All of them. They have an extensive discography.
Scar Tissue was the last one that came out before I left the UK.
Scar Tissue. Oh,
that's the song, right? But the album, Californication.
Yeah, that's a banger album.
Yeah. Oh, actually, and also Stadium Arcadian came out before I left the UK as well, yeah. It's been a long time, man. I mean,
that was their sweet spot.
Yeah. But Red Hot. No, and what is it? One Hot Minute. One Hot Minute?
Yeah.
You remember that one?
Yeah, I don't remember which tracks are off that one, but I recognize
Airplanes on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hump Defunk or whatever it is.
I think that might be earlier, that one.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know better than I do.
I'm a fan, man. I don't know.
Yeah. So much good stuff in the Chili Peppers. Thanks for listening to the Red Hot Chili Peppers episode. We're actually changing the name of our podcast to Red Hot Chili Peppers talk.
It's Red Hot Chili Peppers year on Signl.
Yeah. In celebration. But we're obviously fans. And, listen to that album. What is it called?
Unlimited Love.
There it is.
Oh, I've got so many stories about it. I've got to stop talking about it. Listen to the Rick Rubin podcast. You'll get the information you need.
We'll touch on this.
Yeah.
Once Jay gets back from New Orleans after having listened to the album in full multiple times.
Yeah.
And we'll see where we are at that point.
Maybe we'll do a one-off show about it.
We might have to. I think we just did, Jay.
Yeah.
I think we just did.
We'll just edit all of our clips of us talking in Red Hot Chili Peppers across all episodes.
No, Tom Misch. Yeah. Delete. Yeah. Tom Misch, delete. Yeah, why do we talk so much about Tom Misch?
Yeah.
But we are talking about Tom Misch because he's super cool. And I had a joyous experience researching him and listening to him as I was researching.
Yeah.
Really good stuff. Listen to Geography, but really you can start anywhere with this guy.
Yeah.
Start at the back end, start at the top.
Yeah. And I think if you just go randomly on Spotify and start playing something, you'll get into the vibe.
Yeah. And not to mention all the other collaboration artists he's worked with, that just, you can go down the rabbit hole of really good music really quick with this guy.
Yeah.
So a lot of good stuff, very valuable artist.
Yeah.
He should definitely be on a lot of your playlists.
Yeah.
Let us know what you think. Do we have anything else on Tom Misch?
I don't think so.
Right on.
If I have anything else, I'll follow up on the Red Hot Chili Peppers episode about it.
Sounds good. Yeah. This is almost like a two-parter episode, I feel like. All right. That's all I got. We got a track loaded up to play. Jay is going to hook that up right now. If you guys have any hate mail, any Red Hot Chili Peppers facts for our podcast, let us know at the email, Jay.
roots2grooves@signlradio.com. That's signlradio.com.
Should I bless the track and let it breathe? Yeah, I need a lot, forgot to hit my knees. Yeah, Freddie Kane clocking overseas. Ice minus 4 degrees. Yeah, yeah, well, yeah. Yeah. Jack shit, round trip. Sit your bitch on the round trip. Niggas put real diamonds and fake ass rollies. That's clown shit. Every whip I wish it the German made over Talkin. Super dope, my geek is more media. Robert Townsend and Pouncing. The window shoppers, they brown. Put that on BL, I put BBs in my medallion. They can't understand it, this gangsta shit run the planet. Kept a cannon, even when I was down and out, I was wild, I was wild. I just bless the track, so let it breathe. Yeah, Anisha Lop forgot to hit my knees. Yeah, Freddie Cannon clocking overseas. Rapper of the year, fuck the nominee.
Hardy Corvette, I'll be chasing you down. It's a rock so easily, so easily. Hardy on the dash, I'll be shaking you down. It's a rock so easily, so easily.
Roots to Grooves is a production of Signl Radio. For more music and independent culture, visit signlradio.com. That's SignlRadio.com.